So I googled worst interview questions ever.
Fabulous. I can't wait.
Go ahead.
So what's your favourite colour?
My favourite colour is... That's it.
Navy blue.
Navy blue.
So the drummer and the polymath was an analogy you gave me, which is because you play with, you know, your two hands and your two feet and you sing and you write songs. So is this where you... Is this where you realised back then that, you know, this was the career for you in this world of creativity?
Kind of. I mean, when I was a kid, the only thing that I could do well when I was a youngster was draw. And it saved my life a few times because I was a weedy little kid and I was picked on by bullies. So I used to draw and that used to impress them. And I used to draw pictures of naked ladies and occasionally sell them to the bullies, which was problematic because I didn't really have all the required information to draw them properly when I was seven. But it saved my life, and it was the first inkling that I could actually do something well. Whether it would function and help me exist in the real world, I had no idea. But a number of years later, like many people who lived in Manchester, I wanted to be in a band, in a group. And I started off on guitar, and I was useless. But one day I sat down behind a drum kit, as you were saying, and found that I had the necessary four-wheel drive dexterity to play four things at the same time. And you're quite right, in a sense, that was it was telling me that I could do a number of things at the same time. I felt that there was something that I could do. There were now two things that I could do well, and maybe I could make some kind of a career out of it once I got past all the crap that parents were saying I should be doing.
And so that was the beginning of you with 10cc.
That was before 10cc, many years before 10cc. I had to go through a lot of travelling in the back of Thames vans that used to be, you know, chickens were in the week before, lying on amplifiers and half
paid your dues, so to speak.
Pay our dues and play at ice rinks and weddings and funerals and so on and so forth. But
10cc, I mean, so many iconic songs from many of our, you know, childhood. I just kind of singled out Donna and Rubber Bullets and thought, you know, they're kind of a little bit of a homage to the 50s, but there's a sense of humour about them when you watch the performances of them. And is that that humour, is that seems to be peppered through your career. Is that you or is that you and Godley? Or sorry, you and Cream?
Me and Godley, yeah. It was both.
It's Kevin and Godley.
Yeah. It was, I don't know, it was the chemistry, I guess, of the times.
Yeah.
But, I mean, the interesting thing about making music for us back then was the fact, I think everybody does it to a degree, when you start making music, when you start writing music, you are, to a degree, aping your heroes because that's what you do.
Want to be, yeah.
And I guess we were trying to become the Beatles or the Beach Boys or Simon and Garfunkel or whoever it was we liked at that period of time. But there's a certain point where you do it where... Without realizing it, sometimes you become yourself and you have your own way of doing things in your own sound.
Yeah.
And that's something that creeps up on you.
Yeah.
It's not a design thing because you don't really know who you are yet.
Yeah.
It's a maturity of sorts.
I think, I mean, a lot of composers and musicians in the audience are going to be interested in, you know, the conceptual side of the musical work you did. And later on, we're going to talk about Mondo and how you combine visuals and music together.
Yeah.
But like, for example, the original soundtrack, you know, that Night in Paris is like a three-part, it's like a little three-act story, isn't it?
Yeah.
How did that come about?
We'd written a song on the previous album, which was called Sheet Music, which was quite a long song called Somewhere in Hollywood. And it was a long song because... very good. Much better. One, two. It was a long song. It just turned out that way. But we were testing ourselves as songwriters. We were trying to extend what we could do, and just making something long was an interesting exercise without resorting to a chorus, verse, chorus, solo, verse, chorus structure. We were testing our abilities in a sense, and it worked quite well musically. So for the next album, we were in that writing mode, and we were also big fans of a certain kind of film musical, and we were very into a Gershwin film, George Gershwin. There was a film called An American in Paris with Gene Kelly, that choreographed this amazing movie. And we loved the sound. We loved the fact that music could be long, and we felt restricted by the pop music format.
Yeah.
So again, we wanted to move into something that was more experimental and more advanced.
Yeah,
that's what that was about.
See, because then consequences came soon after that, didn't it?
Or consequences.
Consequences.
Yes. Yes.
And that didn't get received very well, but probably now it's considered a masterpiece in its bravery.
Well, I don't know. Masterpiece or masturbate? one of the. I'm not sure. That was an unfortunate experience for us, and taught us a huge lesson. For those who don't know it, Consequences was a triple album concept that we did shortly after leaving 10cc. And we did it because we'd invented a musical device called the Gizmotron, which essentially strummed automatically the strings of a guitar to simulate the sound of an orchestra. And we wanted to test what this could do. And the project sort of blew up and became got out of hand. It started off as a single album and turned into 18 months of three albums and was very, very silly. But the problem was that we lost contact with the real world while making it. We were in a vacuum in a studio. It was just us. We weren't taking any notice of the real world. And we went stir crazy and we got lost in it.
Yeah.
And by the time we emerged, having finished the project, it was like two Japanese soldiers emerging from the jungle 10 years after the war had ended. And the landscape had completely changed. This thing called punk and new wave had arrived from nowhere. And we were totally wrong-footed. In other words, we were kind of on the wrong side of history. We were in the wrong place at the wrong time for the first time in our lives. And it was like this was our musical Heaven's Gate. And it was exactly how it was received, unfortunately.
Well, it's because Heaven's Gate's considered a masterpiece now, isn't it?
But, yes, but it wasn't considered so then.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
It was a folly back then, at least.
Do you think that people's perception of work, you know, creative work, changes with time? So something that one generation kind of looks at and goes, don't really like that, doesn't work. Yes. Suddenly, three generations later, can embrace it and go, wow, that was incredible.
Yes, I wish I had the objectivity to have an opinion about it, because I know there's some good stuff on there, but because I'm so umbilically attached to the process of making it, it's difficult for me to comment.
Didn't Jimmy Page use the Gizmotron on Intro to the Outdoor?
Yeah.
That's kind of cool, right?
Yeah, a few people used it.
Yeah.
A few people used it. And it's just been brought out again.
You can buy them. They're about $495.
Yeah. There's a new version using proper materials that don't go brittle and fall apart, which the original ones did. So it's out again, out there again.
So obviously inventing stuff is one of the things that you've been known for, and sometimes twisting and torturing and thwarting stuff, like the harmonizer. You were given that. Can you tell us about that?
Yes, we were recording a record. I think the album was called Freeze Frame, and somebody brought this device in called a harmonizer, which allowed you to change the notation of any instrument. I think they use it mostly these days for retuning vocals if somebody's singing slightly flat or sharp. But back then, we didn't really know what it was for. But for some reason, they brought a small keyboard in with it that came with the kit. It was like a one-octave keyboard. And nobody understood or nobody told us what the keyboard was actually for. So we figured, well, okay, what would happen if I was to record a vocal over this backing track that we'd already made that was a monotone, it was one note. And once that had been recorded, we passed the recording through the keyboard, and Lol Cream, my partner, could play what I'd recorded, which is exactly what we did.
Yeah.
And it was like, whoa, this is like a singing robot. And back in 1981 or something, it sounded quite extraordinary.
But didn't you also record your voice so then Lowell could play it synthetically? Isn't that
That's exactly what I'm talking about. I essentially turned my voice into a sample that he could play. So I didn't have to do much singing at all.
Well, you're a terrible singer anyway, so just...
Yeah, I'm hopeless.
I want to take us into directing a little bit now.
Okay.
But it starts, interestingly enough, with music, because the first music video, you guys had the idea for it, but the record company didn't. They wanted a professional director. So take us through that one.
Okay, so our influences, I guess, all the way through our careers, and when I say us, I mean myself and Law Cream, our history is we both started off at art college, so our backgrounds are visual more than anything else. And when we left college, we became musicians. But that desire to do something and feeling for all things visual was always there. And when we started making records on our own after leaving the band, we had ideas for film clips that would go with the music. And we thought, well, why don't we make a film to go with this particular piece of music? It was a song called An Englishman in New York, not the Sting song, if you remember that. It was a different song. But we had an idea for a clip to go with it. So we went to the record label and pitched the idea that we had, and they surprisingly said, yes, we'll do this. But because you've never directed a film before, we're going to get a professional director in to do it for you. And his name was Derek Burbridge, and which is exactly what we did. We went in the studio and we performed for Derek and we did everything. But the whole process of putting this project together, it was an epiphany for us. It was like, this is a new world that we should be involved with. We can do this. This comes from the same place as our hearts and heads came from when we were at art college. And essentially, we took over the process when we were on the shoot and when we were in the edit. We just took the whole thing over.
Yeah.
Whether the finished thing is any good, I don't know. But it kind of taught us everything we needed to know to forge ahead in that world.
Yeah.
And it was like an amazing thing for us.
So, we're talking about like very iconic videos from the late 80s and 90s, like Girls on Film.
Yeah.
That was the famous X-rated one.
Yes.
Two Tribes.
Yes.
Herbie Hancock's Rocket. It goes on and on, like Graham Parker and the Rumours. U2. Oh, no, not at that point, U2.
No.
But The Police.
Yes.
Yeah. How did you and Cream work together as a dynamic? What was the creative? Like, did one of you do, like, talking to the band and the other one work the camera, or did you just freeform?
We both did everything, pretty much. And I suppose I'm ashamed to say, or not that ashamed, but this was what? This is talking like the early 80s.
Mm-hmm.
We used to smoke a lot of hashish, which kind of helped at the time to put us in the zone. But how we worked together, we both did everything, and I've no recollection on how that became a problem.
Yeah.
We worked together, all told, as a team for 27 years, and we operated as two halves of the same brain. One would start something and the other one would finish the sentence, as it were. And that functioned extremely well for that length of time.
So it's like a marriage, really, isn't it?
It was like a marriage. A creative marriage, and it worked extremely well. And so, you know, when preparing a shoot, you know, is this any good? Is that any good? It was all about the balance. It was always all about discussion, ideas backwards and forwards. And on a shoot, one of us would be talking to, like, the bass player, another one would be talking to the drummer, and then one of us would have an inspiration and talk to everybody. We just kind of took over from each other at every stage of the game.
Yeah.
And it just worked.
Yeah.
It just worked. So,
I mean, I think we're going to sort of see as we go along here, amazing sort of layers here where you know, you work with sound and you work with picture and then you come up with concepts outside of that. And that, obviously, the strengths are all feeding each other. But with Mondo Video, that's the tree piece. You're mixing, that's really about an audio visual piece that was way ahead of its time in terms of advertising, because like the Honda ad probably did it, you know, where you've got sound effects of something that are actually musical with music.
Yes.
How did that come about?
Mondo Video was an experimental project, a three-part experimental project where the brief we gave ourselves was, or the question we asked ourselves is, can we create music and pictures at the same time? Can one discipline feed off the other? Mm. So we booked 3 days at Olympic Recording Studios in London and took some musical instruments in, as you would, but took cameras in and lighting in with us as well, to create a situation where the two could feed off each other and inform each other. And we just did a load of mad shit over 3 days to see what would happen. I mean, it sounds kind of ambitious and pretentious and all those kind of words, but we felt a responsibility at that time not only to deliver commercially successful films, but a need to take the form somewhere else and to discover what we discovered in it. Could it do anything else?
Yeah, because I think, you know, commercial, very commercial projects tend to push you into that space. It's kind of the money, you know, and it's sometimes, you, no matter how much you fight it, you're best to do the best job you can in that space. So you need, I think you need those experimental sort of avant-garde work as well, you know?
Yeah, it doesn't have to work. Yeah. You know, it's thank goodness we weren't medical students because we would have killed a number of people. But yeah, we gave ourselves permission to do that because nobody else was doing it.
Yeah.
You know.
So you split with Cream, Made Out on Your Own, right?
Yeah.
And that was around, there was a project called One World, One Voice.
It was before that. That was the thing that I did after we split. But what happened is, as you can imagine, if you're working with one other person for the totality of your creative life, in this case 27 years, it would be kind of bizarre if there weren't cracks starting to appear in that at a certain time. And towards the end, which was 1998, I would say, 1989, my apologies. We were different people. We were hanging out with different people. Our tastes were beginning to change. We were beginning to separate to a degree. Instead of being Siamese twins, we were now different people.
Yeah.
Or conjoined twins, I think is the correct terminology.
The One World, One Voice project, which is like a hour-long sort of live, it's like a stream of consciousness, one track recorded by musicians all over the world. Mm. So you're obviously what I would call an ideas director. Some directors are just like a director for hire and they just show up and go and they direct. And then other directors are like ideas people. So they, and you're very much that kind of a director. But like when you come up initially with an idea as huge and amazing as that, do you, if it suddenly starts to happen, do you go have a holy shit moment where you go, oh, fuck, I've actually got to make this now?
Yeah.
You do. And how do you deal with this?
And, and all the way through it.
Because you just don't know until it's done.
Because an idea like that no one's done before. So what are the rules? Mm. I mean, the first thing was, A, thinking of the idea and then seeing if we could get the powers that be to agree to do it. And in this case, it was BBC Two and international broadcasters.
Yeah.
And it was to kind of celebrate the end of 2 weeks of environmental concern broadcasting. Originally, they wanted like a Live Aid kind of concert.
Yeah.
And they brought me in to think of something that was maybe a little bit more unusual than that. And this was my solution to the problem. But surprisingly, they all said, go for it. So as you quite rightly said, it was holy shit moment. Yeah. How do we do this?
Yeah.
And this was in a world before samples, before email, before Dropbox, before mobile phones.
Posting tapes to people.
This was posting, this was posting, you know, audio cassettes and DATs off to America, off to Africa, off to places all around the world, and people listening to unfinished pieces of music, learning and understanding how they could add to it, and then us showing up and recording them and filming them and moving on to the next city. It was insane how we managed to pull it off.
Yeah. Did you think that, like, did you, were you able to, were you as much a producer on that as a director, in that you were you organising artists? Because quite a few famous artists on it that you might have worked with.
No. No. I kind of knew that I didn't have the facility to do that. I kind of cut myself off. We hired a team of people who were specialists in their area. We hired a music producer, Rupert Hine. We hired a DOP, Joe Dyer, mm-hmm. and we had a very experienced producer travelling with us and a line producer travelling with us. So it was kind of a core team, a very small crew, very small team, and they all had very specific jobs to do. My job was essentially to show up in Paris or Rome or wherever the hell we were supposed to be with my little camera crew and shoot the hell out of whatever it was that these people had just recorded to our evolving piece of music. And we had very little materials with us. We had one 16mm camera, one video camera, and a bag full of leaves and newspapers and a blue cloth and a black cloth and a white cloth and whatever pieces of stuff we could find on the day to make this particular shot interesting.
Yeah.
It was very improvisational, and we were listening to what they were doing. What does this look like, and how can we make it work with what we have in our bag?
But, like, there can't be too many directors out there who can tackle a project like that, because obviously the mix of that alone, the sound mix of that alone, is a massive job. So were you all over that part of it as well?
No.
Oh, you
I wasn't.
You just stayed away?
We began editing the project, film editing the project, before the finished sound existed. So how it tended to work, we were kind of feeding off each other, a little bit like Mondo Video, but not quite. In other words, I knew that the beginning of the piece was going to be this combined with that, so I would begin to edit. And then that would inspire Rupert to say, maybe we could add Laurie Anderson to this part, right, and Lou Reed there, and so on and so forth. So we were talking to each other creatively to a degree.
And would that mean then you would suddenly feel like, OK, I need to get some more footage for that section because there's a whole new layer I have to go to?
No. Okay. There was no going after more footage.
Right.
It was
too big.
It was what we had was what we had.
Yeah.
Was like we were out there for, I can't remember how long it was. It was maybe 6 weeks or something, travelling around the world.
Right.
And then there was a deadline to meet for the live broadcast of the finished show. And so it was, you know, heads down, yeah, noses to the grindstone.
I mean, I noticed a pattern in your work, you know, whereby you have this sort of project this piece of work that's amazing, and then you kind of return to it in a different format years later. I'm picking on you.
It self-controls it. In okay. other words, the first person who records a video and plays something, if you play to that, it will automatically be in sync with it.
Right.
It works exactly the same as working in a recording studio like this, but there's also a visual component as well.
And that's your video, so to speak.
That is it. And you can record up to six people at the same time on one track.
Amazing.
And that was a direct descendant of One World, One Voice.
Yeah, it does feel there's a similarity in them, you know.
Well, it's me suddenly realizing that I'd done this all those years ago, and one of the things that happened on the way from one recording to another is we had to walk across a beach, and there were some local musicians just playing like buskers. One was a saxophone player, another was an acoustic guitar player. And we kind of stopped on the way and we had them play on our evolving piece of music. Just ordinary guys on the street. And that stuck with me as being a very important moment. So when I got interested in the online experience, it was like, well, maybe there's a way that everybody could do this now.
Right.
That's the genesis of it.
Yeah, right. Let's jump back a little bit. So when you split with Cream, you went out on your own, so now you're directing. So
yes.
What was your first directing experience like?
The first thing I did was a video for a band called Fine Young Cannibals. I think the song's called Don't Look Back.
Don't Look Back, yeah.
Not a great piece of work, and it was quite terrifying at the time to be suddenly on my own doing a music video.
Yeah.
There was no one to turn to say, well, what do you think of that? What do you think of the other? But I got through it, and it worked quite well.
I know you just signed... At that point, you were signing your treatments, Kevin and Sue. So was Sue, like... It's Sue's your wife, right?
Sue's my wife.
Sue's there somewhere. There she is. And was Sue a collaborator? Or
Sue is a provocateur. She keeps me on track and makes sure that my taste buds are working as they should be. And if I'm doing something that's really shit, she'll tell me.
Sounds like every director needs one of these.
Yes. But she's very smart. She's got some pretty good ideas of her own. So right. We are moving into collaboration mode.
You are?
Yeah, I think
okay.
So.
Like a project that you are running together?
Yeah.
What is it?
I can't tell you.
So I'm trying to get into the idea part now of Godley. You know, when you get it, you get a music, you know, get a track.
Yeah.
And as I remember getting myself, and it's like, okay, you got to come up with an idea. What's your process here?
I immerse myself in it. I sit down. Obviously, I listen to it lots. And even though it very rarely stimulates anything, I ask for a copy of the lyrics, and I go online and I look at the people involved, and something usually comes.
Mm.
But it can be sparked by any of those components. It's because all I'm trying to do with the music videos that I make, I never, ever try and tell the story. I think that's a really bad idea. Yeah. If somebody's singing about, you know, I just pulled up in a white car and got out and spotted this beautiful girl in a restaurant, and I go in and we talk, and then we go off to another club and we dance and we go back to her place, and the inevitable happens. I'm not going to show that.
Yeah.
Because the song is telling you that. You don't want to be banged over the head with that. I just want to come up with a framework that helps that musician tell his story and an atmosphere that suits the song. So I'm being driven by the overall sound,
right,
not the story. The lyric to me is partially irrelevant, although there may be clues in there.
Yeah, I mean, I think when I did my very first music video, my producer at the time, Ned O'Hanlon, he said to me, just go with your gut. The first idea that comes into your head is
film
the
your gut.
Best one. Film your gut, yeah.
Good idea.
Yeah. So, and I kind of stuck to it. Do you find that happens as well? Like, it's the first idea. If you try to work too many ideas, the first one's the one?
To a degree, but because what you said earlier is very interesting, commercial art, right? So there's an element of commerce involved. You come up with an idea that is a reaction to the piece of music, but it's going to cost 50 grand, yeah, and you've only got 12.
Yeah.
So...
That's where it starts, right?
Yeah. But you're right. I mean, there is something in that idea, so maybe there's a way of doing that idea in a different way. But yes, I think it's probably the same with any discipline. If you're an architect or a writer or a sculptor or a painter, you develop an instinct for your medium. So the kind of ideas you come up with are probably the ones you want to go with anyway.
Right.
So, and yes, in many times, it's the first idea that you want to make somehow.
So we have, I warned you about this now, right? The on-the-spot challenge here, right? Okay? See if we can figure out what your brain's like and how it functions. You get a call. Lady Gaga has recorded Rubber Bullets and wants you to be the music video director.
Right.
What's the video?
Okay.
Told you. I warned you.
What's the video? Oh.
Exactly.
What's it sound like?
I think if it's not fair. Originally it's quite funny, isn't it? It's like a humorous thing and it's got an energy. I think if she's going to do it, she's going to go dark with it.
Okay. I'm assuming there's a tempo like that, and there's a heavy bass drum. So what I might do is try to simulate what a bass drum might look like, or a bass drum pedal might look like, if the bass drum pedal was Lady Gaga. So, okay, so this is the camera. this is Lady Gaga, and she's going boom, boom, boom. But obviously, the insurance people would not let me do that. But what I might do is do the opposite and create a rig whereby she's in one position and I'm lifting the camera towards her. Which, in if we were to film that in like a limbo situation, a white or a black limbo, you would not know that was happening because all you would see was movement.
Yeah.
Oops, like so. And so that would be a kind of, maybe that would be where I would start to have her simulate some of the sounds on the piece of music.
So it's, I mean, if you look at, say, Mondo and the piano piece, right?
Yeah.
You created a sort of performance, musical performance of the performance, and he's jump cutting around playing the piano. And then in sort of, was it Wang Chung, the video?
Wang Chung, yes.
Yeah. They're doing this. There's sort of, it feels like he shot it in stop motion. And
well, no, what we didn't.
How did you work that?
That's another good example of being inspired by available technology. The Wang Chung video that he's talking about was a track called Everyone Have Fun Tonight, or Everybody Have Fun Tonight. And we shot a lock-off looking into the corner of a large wooden room and shot maybe 10 different situations going on. But the edit suite we were using had this desk made by a company called Grass Valley. And it had a sequencer in it. You could sequence, much as you can program music, you could create a sequence that would cut between the different camera sources. And we thought, well, what would happen if you cut every two frames? So essentially, that video was just cutting between every single shot we'd made, two frames of each.
So you cut the video, you shot the performance, cut the video, and then you applied this.
No, that was the cut.
That was the cut.
The program we made is cut between those 10 shots.
Yeah.
Cut between 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10, 2 frames of this, 2 frames of that, 2 frames of that. It was automatic animation in itself. Yeah. At the time we didn't really know exactly what it would look like.
Yeah.
But we, again, it was our instincts were telling us that it would look interesting.
I think when we were chatting, I was telling you about the Miracle of Joey Ramone video that I did.
The virus, right? Yes.
And then the one I kind of like got involved in at a certain point. My version of it was, because the song was inspired by their influence and the band's influence in the 70s and the Ramones and stuff, I was trying to create an analog kind of feel to it.
Yeah.
But we're caught in this digital world now where it's just, you know, there's nothing. Analog is made to feel like it's being facilitated rather than it's part of a process.
Yeah.
And so we got our performance of the band, and then I put backgrounds behind it, and then we would create viruses and infect the codecs and just press render and just go away and come back and find little diseased bits and go, oh, that's a good bit, and that's a good bit. I do too. And it's like what I'm curious about in is, like, in the old days, let's call it, you were always looking for those sort of like happy sort of
God-given accidents.
The loss of the chance moment, I think you might have called it once.
I'd prefer to work in something I call a digilog world, which is a combination of analog and digital, because I come from a musical background, and a lot of music that we made was the result of happy accidents. You'd hit the wrong chord or try something unexpected that actually turned out to be far better than what you originally set out to do. And the opportunity to make that happen in the digital environment is fast disappearing.
Yeah.
When we used to edit in the analog world, we could press buttons to cut between different shots. We could use these things called paddles to manually fade, or dissolve. So you were actually only one stage removed from the material, whereas in film editing, you weren't removed at all. That was total manual
control.
You could
scratch it and you could fuck it up.
Yeah, you were actually physically playing with what you could do. Now, because I have no real technical aptitude, I'm working with an editor who calculates stuff and then shows it to me. And then I'm saying, well, that's kind of nice, but can you try it shorter? And he'll do it again. But there's no real connection with the material, no physical connection with the material.
Yeah, I mean, I used to love working on pneumatic tapes because as you cut over them and over them, the tape would start to break down and you'd get these brilliant bleeds and you'd want that. You know, and then the nightmare was in the telecine, like how do you recreate it? And of course it's pneumatic. I think I put one commercial out on air that was directly from pneumatic because I got so frustrated, you know. But it's an interesting analog versus digital
Don't understand why it should be versus. I mean, what kind of brought it home to me was the ridiculous situation of being in a very small hotel room and having a TV set here and wanting to turn the volume up and searching for the remote and finding it, then navigating my way through a ridiculously complex menu to find the volume when I really should be able to go, It's like technology is supposed to assist you and make things easier to do, but sometimes it doesn't.
Yeah.
And it takes longer.
For you to be the polymath, as we say, right? Mm-hmm. I feel you've reinvented yourself many, many times. And I remember when Octum Baby came out, you two were reinventing themselves and their image and their whole style. And you were involved in all that, sort of those early days of that reinvention. Tell us about that a little bit.
To a degree. I was asked to do their second single from, I think it was Acton Baby. Even Better Than the Real Thing. And I approached it the same way as I approach most things. I was looking for a way in that captured the spirit of the song, the feeling of the song. And I came up with this camera rig, not the technicality of the rig itself, but a look that I wanted that a company called Artem managed to put together for me. But being involved in filming the show itself was an incredible experience. I did a thing called Zoo TV Outside Broadcast for Channel 4. And so we were on the road with you two for a good few weeks. But the extraordinary thing about it, as you say, they were in the process of becoming something new, shedding the purest ethics of Joshua Tree and embracing media and the modern world.
It was a very exciting time, but it was also... It was horrendous sometimes because there was such a nervous energy because no one knew. It was like what you're saying about you don't know when you're experimenting.
Yeah.
You never know until it's done.
But the thing was, while we were on the road with them, the show was changing every night because everybody that was involved on the creative side, the visual creative side, were doing things for the show.
Yeah.
It's like somebody would have an idea, one of the band or one of the crew, or why don't we do this? Because that would go great with that. Okay, go out and shoot this, go out and do that, or find a piece of footage and fuck it up. And so the show was finding its own feet,
it was really,
as it would, and becoming Zoo TV, and only probably became the final Zoo TV by the end of the tour. But it was an incredibly convoluted, challenging, but exciting process.
Yeah. I remember doing some work on the screens where Mark Pellington came into town with a bunch of stuff. I think he called it like Slash or Stash.
Yeah.
And it was just loops of stuff that he'd got from Buzz TV. And we set up the Ace. The Ace is like it's like a big online desk that works. It's like an analog desk. And so four of us would sit down at the desk and then all of the Beta machines... We're all running loops, and then we'd play the songs from the show, and we'd all start just playing. We were VJing, right?
Yeah.
But I'd suddenly realise, oh, that's great on Adam when he comes on at the bass, or that's great with that. And we'd start, and we would record everything. And we were supposed to be there for a couple of hours, and we just worked through the night. There was such a buzz about it creatively. No one wanted to leave. We just wanted to try another one and another one.
I'll tell you what was interesting about this, which is something I'd never experienced before or after. Before the tour started, we were flown out to where they were rehearsing. I think it was in Hershey. They'd hired a stadium to do dress rehearsals. Mm. A fascinating experience. So myself, Gavin Friday and Sue would sit there with notebooks. It was like we were auditioning you two. And they'd play the set for us. And we would go, that's not bad.
Yeah.
That's good. That could maybe move there. What happens if this happens? And after each show, we would sit down with the band and do a post-mortem. And then some of those ideas will be dismissed, and some will be thought about, some will be developed. And that was how the show came to be. Right. It was a fascinating experience.
It was pretty incredible. Yeah. It was like, it was an audiovisual experience like nothing else, you know?
Oh.
Especially in the 90s, and I remember it myself, you would often, as a director, find yourself in sort of mad situations where things go a little bit south and you've got to figure something out and kind of get through it. I've Got You Under My Skin, you ended up having tacos with Frank Sinatra. So tell us how that happened.
Okay, Frank Sinatra did an album of duets, and one of the tracks he did was the old classic song, I've Got You Under My Skin, with Bono. And we obviously wanted to create a piece of film that had Frank in it, but getting to do anything with Frank was difficult. Obviously, he's a huge artist. So the only thing that we managed to pull off was to meet him in a bar in Palm Springs, because he knew the owners of the bar, and it was kind of brokered by a friend of his. But we couldn't be shooting a video because he didn't really know what a video was. So all we could do was hide maybe 15 or so lipstick cameras, which are tiny little things, behind bottles and pillars and palm trees, and capture the moment when he came in. And the basic idea was that he would show up with a bottle of rare scotch and hand it to Bono by the bar, and they would chat for a few minutes, and we'd capture all this on 15 cameras. So what could possibly go wrong? So we positioned the bar stool where we wanted Frank to sit, just so. And in Frank came, and he walks over to the bar, hands the bottle to Bono, and then moves the bar stool 2 feet to his left and sits down. And on 15 cameras, we got like an elbow, the top of his head, a knee, and a waiter passing through frame with a pizza. And it was like, in other words, we just fucked up. We didn't take the human condition into consideration. So someone pushed me out from behind the palm tree I was throwing up behind. And I had to go and say hello to Frank and tell him why we were there, and ask him to do another take. And I was like, who the fuck are you? I'm the director of what? The video, what's a video? And it was kind of getting out of hand. And he was kind of getting twitchy and banging his feet. And the guy who brokered this meeting leant over to me and said, that thing he's doing here, he only usually does it when he's got a 38 in his belt. And
not good.
Anyway, to cut a long story short, we had more conversations, and we changed the idea of what was going to happen. This time is Frank would be sat in position at the bar, and Bono would arrive and give him the scotch.
Okay, good.
And we struck all the lipstick cameras and got our 16mm camera ready to shoot, and action, Bono comes in and the camera jams. So we did it maybe 3 times, and then we wanted another take, and he stormed out. He called us a bunch of amateurs and left. And we had maybe 30 seconds of usable material in the can for a song that lasted 3.5. And so that's a fuck-up, I think. That qualifies.
At least you had that in the can.
At least we had it, but making a loop of it wasn't an option then. So the task was, how do we fill this out? And sometimes when you're given a problem like that, you make magic happen because you have to. So we used some stock footage of Frank. We went out driving with Bono in the back, and camera crew was sat in the back of an open-top car, and we went through this theme park with dinosaurs in it. And then we went in the studio for a day and wrote stuff on people's bodies. And there was other footage of Bono in the back of a limousine with Frank. And then we went home. But before we went home, and while we were still at the club, very miserable and downhearted with our 30 seconds, we got a message back from Frank's wife saying, Frank would like to apologize for his behavior earlier and would like to invite you all back to the house later for dinner. So we go back to the house, and he's serving everybody drinks from this bar, and then takes us out to dinner to a local Mexican restaurant. But the wonderful memory I have is being at the restaurant, we, Sue and myself, managed to sit directly opposite Frank, who was lovely and delightful. But at one point during the meal, he sort of popped a taco and then looked over at Sue and went, "Strangers in the night." Exchanging. He was singing to my wife.
Happy days,
it was
right?
Like, fuck me. And that's kind of my final memory of it, apart from the actual edit, of course, which was a whole other situation.
And Sue then. See you, Kevin.
I'm off with this Frank guy. Yeah. But it was something else. It really was something else.
Just want to, because we need to. I want to try and get through a couple more things.
Okay, go.
Hog Fever.
Hmm.
Hog Fever is a ear movie, in your words, which was originally going to be a movie and had a script.
Yeah.
And you had trouble getting it financed, so you turned it.
Well, it initially wasn't my project. What it was based on a book that a friend of mine had written. Hog Fever was a book about a biker's experience, an LA biker's experience living in London. And he'd written this book and figured, we were introduced by a mutual friend, figured it would make a good film script, which it did. But it was a bit too wacky, so it sat on a shelf for a while. But at some point over the last few years, he decided he was going to do an audio book. And the original idea he wanted to do was to take the original book that he'd written and just talk through it. But then he said, well, why don't we do our script? But do it with sound effects and like a proper full production radio play. And his best friend was Terence Stamp.
That is.
And, you know, so the ingredients were there to do something. In a sense, there's a similarity between this and one component of the Consequences project that was perhaps the bit that failed the most.
Yeah.
But it was an interesting experience. And here was an opportunity to do essentially a play. But we had to rewrite it from scratch to fit this new medium of sound only. That was quite a challenge.
I mean, it does seem to me that you've been circling the wagons of making a movie for a very long time. Like, it's the long form, and you've nearly gone in. And I know you did, you know, do the thing that all directors do when you start getting successful. You go over to LA and try and get the Hollywood movie. So how did that go for you?
Well, it was sort of an exploratory trip to see how things work over there. And at the time, this is Lola and myself, we were quite hot as directors, and they're always interested in hot. So off we go, and we probably met about a dozen different executives from different studios. And it was kind of a very predictable experience, really, looking back. And at the time, I think we were pitching this idea for a movie which was based on Gershwin's music, George Gershwin. We were big George Gershwin fans. You probably realize that by now. And we'd written a film that was based on his music, and we were trying to pitch this. And we were getting blank looks, you know, glazed over wherever we went. And I was getting kind of... I was getting the vibe that maybe I should try something. Maybe I should bullshit as much as they are. So in the final meeting, I lied, essentially. I said, in the north of England, there is a club where teenagers are going, and they're wearing 1940s suits and hair from George Gershwin's era, and they've invented this new dance, and they are Gershing. And the guy goes, wow, that's great. And his eyes lit up. It was like suddenly there was a possible commercial cult to hang this on.
That's all he needed, really.
That's all he needed. That's what he was waiting to hear. But, of course, there wasn't. But it was an interesting expedition, shall we say.
And you have a script now that you're writing. Hopefully this is going to be your movie.
Yes. I was lucky enough. My dear wife showed me this article in a newspaper about Orson Welles. I've always been a huge fan of Orson Welles. And apparently his first professional role as an actor took place at the Gate Theatre here in 1931.
Yeah.
And he spent time here as a teenager, he was 16, came over here on a so-called cultural trip, but worked his way around the country painting and ended up at the Gate Theatre and was a massive hit. That was the first time he'd experienced...
I think he lied and said he was a big
he
actor.
He said he was a major Broadway star.
That's right.
And they hired him on the spot because he had magnetism and charisma. But there's something about that story of the young Orson Welles, the Welles that nobody knows beyond the large, blustering man, yeah, full of confidence. This was before that person existed. This was the embryonic Welles.
Yeah.
That story fascinates me, and also seeing that through the prism of the older man. And the strap line I'm using at the moment is, I'm calling it the gate. It's the story of how a young boy found himself as told by a man who lost himself.
That's
because
true. That's the poster.
Yeah, maybe. But that's how I'm seeing it. And I don't know, for the first time I feel I've found a project that is giving me the kind of meat, yeah, that I can really get my teeth into, even though I'm a vegetarian.
Right. Okay, and...
And the IFB has very kindly given me a loan to write the script.
It. Yeah.
So that kind of validates it for me.
So, you know, all that we were talking right at the start about And I'm Paris, which is like a little three-act story, and then,
yep,
you know, and all the way through your career, you've got this long form. You're actually kind of telling stories, although you say you don't.
Well,
you
I allow the stories to be told.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're just not literally.
No.
But, yeah. So... I guess this is the movie that sort of brings it all together, really, isn't it?
Well, I hope so. I'm very excited about doing it, and I'm writing it, which is great fun. And I feel like I've been inhabited by Orson Welles.
Yeah.
I keep coming up with ideas. Even Sue keeps coming up with ideas that are so awesome.
Yeah,
they're awesome.
Awesome, dude.
Yeah.
Dude. And, it's there, yeah, Space Cake, which is your book.
Yes, it's not an autobiography, it's a memoir.
It's a memoir.
There's a difference.
It's like a fluid stream of consciousness.
Yes.
But actually, what's kind of genius about it is that it feels just like a fluid stream of consciousness, but it's really detailed and really precise. And was that a writing... It sort of basically takes you through his entire career in somewhat, and some amusing anecdotes and some amazing facts and how the whole process of what everything Kevin has done, how it takes place. But it's very funny and it's kind of, you can't really put it down. But the style of the writing, I think, really, did you choose that like a treatment, or is that just how you write?
No, I had no idea I was going to do. I mean, I knew the subjects I was going to cover. But again, it's a good example of how I interact with Sue on a creative level.
Yeah.
She said, why not do it like a script?
Yeah.
That sounds like a really good idea. And in so doing, I thought it might be quite interesting to have two versions of me. One is like the kind of cynical version of me, and the other version is the version that talks too much and gets pretentious and goes on and on and on. Whereas the cynical one says, shut the fuck up and just tell the story.
Yeah.
It made it an enjoyable experience to write like that. But it was kind of stream of consciousness.
Yeah.
Not necessarily all totally accurate stream of consciousness, which is why it's more of a memoir than an autobiography.
Yeah.
But one thing that I did discover in the process, when I was talking about my very early years and going back to being able to draw and playing the drums and so forth, and, you know, becoming creative versus having to find a proper job in life. I remember my father always wanted me to come into the family business, which was, he had a number of shops in Manchester selling cameras, radios, tape recorders, TVs, records, and musical instruments. And I didn't want to join the family business. I didn't want to go into the business at all. But I realized by the time that I finished writing the book, I'd gone into every single one of those businesses.
You just named them all. Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
It's kind of everything's come full circle, which is an interesting thing.
It is, yeah. Maybe we can, if there's any questions anybody has for Kevin.
I'm a little hard of hearing, sort of battle scars from being in a band all these years. But
is there any questions out there?
to say that I remember working with you many, many years ago in London.
Yeah.
And when you were writing with Jerry Chater. And about how I'm interested that you were saying about the discovery of things, how you could screw up analog video equipment.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
Happy accidents, yeah.
Which is what I remember.
Well, that was. It's okay. You're told that this is what this piece of machinery does. But like, you're thinking, what else can it do? And you're driven by what you actually made so far. And something is coming. Something is saying you need something else. And as you well know, like, you know, in the machine room was almost a religiously protected environment. So two fuckers going in there with screwdrivers and cattle prods was not... Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. The engineers used to go absolutely...
Oh, yeah.
Because the stuff had to be rephased and relined up again.
Yeah, but we did that all the time. We just... We broke a lot of people as well, actually.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it was...
It was exciting, yeah. I think the idea is that the accidents was an experimental thing whereby it was always felt better than your own idea. In a way, right? And they would always end up in the video.
Well, it's good accidents are great. Good accidents are great. They're God-given.
Yeah.
But you do piss off a lot of people by doing that sometimes.
That's true. the film industry, though, loves a challenge. I mean, there's nothing that they love more than to try and come up with a new shot that's never been done and try and figure it out. And they'll invent things to help make that happen. I mean, that's definitely an energy that's in the film production world.
Well, you know, it's interesting. I mean, just to take a little step back, when I started reading up about Orson Welles and the way he used to work, he said something very interesting which resonated with me. Somebody asked him, or people have asked him over the years, where do you get your confidence from to try all this new stuff? And he said, ignorance.
Yeah, it protects you.
Yeah, and I totally get that. It's like, if you don't know what the rules are, you can't break them. You have to make your own rules up. And that's what he did constantly. Yeah. And that's what we're doing. That's what we're doing here. No one said, well, actually, a few people did after a while, that you can't go in here and press buttons and put screwdrivers in there and slow things down and speed things up. We just had half-formed visions that we knew we had to try and make real, and we just were constantly looking for ways to make that happen.
Yeah. I think, if I may say, that the gear had the potential to go wrong more than digital equipment, because it was analog, and you could turn a pot one way or the other way. You know, it was always supposed to be set correctly.
Yeah.
But you could always turn it.
The colours would go off.
And
But wonderful.
I think though, there's an aspect of it is you just need to embrace digital and love it. You know, like we were talking about some of the images that you had where you took stills and they got corrupted and broken down, a bit like the viruses I created. And then you were like, he actually designed a piece of software to create that. It would have been on previous stuff. Yeah.
What happened was, again, it was the whole process was accidental. I'd recently done a music video that I edited here, and there they are. And for whatever reason, it was a very post-heavy thing, and I couldn't go in that day. So I asked them to send the cut as it stood to me, and it got corrupted on the way when I downloaded. It was a mess. So I asked them to resend it. But while I was waiting, I sort of scrolled through what they'd sent me, and every fourth frame was an extraordinary work of art. It was like, fuck. So I was kind of wondering, well, what would happen if I ran my showreel through this? But there was no this. It was an accident. So I found a guy who subsequently became a great friend, and he made me a very simple piece of software that I could plug into Final Cut and run anything I wanted through it, and it would destroy it in the same way. And again, that's exactly what I did, and these are some of the images that came up. It's just from my showreel.
So do you think when it comes to your movie, you think there's going to be that aspect to it? Are you going to
I think I'll do as much of that in pre-production as I can.
Good plan.
Because I think that when you make a movie, you have a certain responsibility. It's not like pissing around with video anymore. I'm trying to tell a story about somebody who I admire.
There
will be a little bit of that.
Yeah.
But I think I will try and pin it down as much as possible at storyboarding stage, scripting stage, and make it more of a cerebral thing than an effects thing.
Yeah. I just remember what I used to do was, because I knew I had to deliver something at the end of the day, 80% of what I do would be, I knew was going to work because it wasn't taking a chance.
Yes.
And I'd always have that 20% that I'd just go mad and experiment and, you know, mess with it.
You can get lost in it. You can get lost in that. That's the only problem. That's, as I said earlier, I was kind of feel a bit weird about saying it, that we did smoke a lot of hash back then. But what it, even though it's helpful in some respects, what it did do that was bad, it gave you tunnel vision, and you would home in on this thing and worry it to death. And then you had what you consider to be a perfect 5-second sequence, but the other 3 hours was garbage. And that has gone from my life now. I am able to harness the creative juices in different ways and understand that the bigger picture, particularly if you're making a picture, that is the most important thing.
And what about the sound aspect of the picture? Have you thought about that yet?
I have a vague sense of what the sound might be, but only the vaguest sense at this stage.
Is it, what's driving it? Do you know? Can you tell us where you're taking your direction from? Is it music or is it?
Well, I enjoy sound design as much as music, so it's going to be a combination of the both, I think. What it won't be is sort of zithers. Aping the third man, you know, it won't be that.
Yeah.
It'll be contemporary, but sort of drawing on that period, maybe, but in a different way. It'll be quite strange. I know that.
Yeah, it sounds great. And Andrew, your producer, was telling me that maybe Seamus McGarvey might be lighting it for you, that's a little coup in itself.
Yes.
Yeah.
Lovely.
Yeah, you're gonna love him.
The thing that kicked me off more than anything else, in the article that Sue found, there is a picture of a 16-year-old Orson Welles driving a donkey and cart through Ireland, looking happy as a pig in shit. Wonderful.
Yeah.
I'm trying to capture something of that, I think.
Yeah, it looks stunning.
Yeah.
Period.
Yeah.
Is there anybody else wants to ask anything here? Or? Over here?
I have a drummer question for you, Kevin. Over here.
Oh. Yes.
And one of the images that came up on the slides earlier, that's cool. And it's just a very small little portrait. And I think there are two kinds of drummers in the world, those who love Ringo and those who don't. Which are you?
Hang on 1 minute. What was the question again? The battle scars.
There's two types of drummers in the world.
Yeah.
Ones who love Ringo and ones who don't. Which one are you?
I love Ringo. I love Ringo, because he's a very musical drummer.
There's a little image of him in one of these slides.
Yeah.
I'm wondering what the context of that is.
I don't know, because they're behind me. I didn't see. Let me see.
It's the one with Sting on it, and there's just a little, what looks like a picture of Ringo above him. There you go.
Oh, right. It was. I did a Beatles video.
Is that what that's from?
Those are four shots from it, yeah. It's... the song was called Real Love. It was when they did a documentary. I think it was a series, amazing documentary, and I was asked to do a video, the second single that was released. And so I got to film all of them, except for John Lennon, obviously. But the way I filmed them was to simulate something that Yoko Ono did with John Lennon. She filmed him at something like 5,000 frames per second. Just looking into camera and smiling, so I did that with the other three and used that as the basis to cut in and out of archive footage that I had. So that's the context. But yes, I think Ringo was a genius.
Just here, Anya.
Obviously over the years, 30 years or so, you have witnessed technology change. You've been at the cutting edge of excited about that and you feel there's endless possibilities. And of the today and now, who impresses you most? Have you seen something that you felt, gosh, what a wonderful opportunity to be able to do that right now?
That's a complicated question. I am excited by technology. There are certain aspects of technology that don't excite me and seem kind of pointless, but maybe that's just me. I don't get excited by autonomous cars. That worries the hell out of me. And I suppose the things that do excite me are the ones that are directly applied to what I do. And I haven't really dabbled in it in any way, shape, or form as yet, but I'd love to get involved in VR and all that. That world sounds very, very interesting. It's a whole new set of challenges there. I'd love to be involved in that. But as you say, everything is moving so quickly. But the other thing that is moving quickly that I also have to bear in mind is how people receive it. How people receive the information, and to stay on top of what is required to excite people. And it may not be the way I used to excite them. I may have to come up with something that lasts for a minute that is incredible, as opposed to something that lasts for 20 minutes that is incredible, because people might not have the attention span to watch that. It's staying equipped to deal with the future as it changes. I think that's part of the deal.
Yeah. And finding that new piece of technology that you can play with and mess up and find something new. And
yeah, it's like, you know, okay, your first video camera or your first VCR player or your first Polaroid camera. That at the time was like revolutionary.
Yeah.
And so you apply it to what you do and you use it and you come up with something that's individual, which is what I hope to continue to do.
Okay. Is anybody else then?
That's a no.
That's the secret handshake then, isn't
yeah.
it? Should we call
right.
it quits? All right. Thanks very much, everybody.
Thank you.
It's a hasty retreat.